Hey you guys, it's Alex. I'm here to do another DIY video for you guys today. So as a few of you know, if you follow me on Instagram, you know that I've been working on this small closet office renovation. And unfortunately, while I was hanging some wall shelves, I actually hit an electrical wire in my wall. So because I hit this wire in my wall, we actually did have to have an electrician come through, repair all of the electrical work that had to be done. And because of this, he did have to cut quite a large hole in our wall. And I do have to patch this. I do have to patch up the vapor barrier that was cut through as well. So for anybody that has cut through an exterior wall, you typically do have vapor barrier. This is important because it actually helps keep any of the moisture and like the drafts out of your house. From what I understand, if I was to patch this without repairing the vapor barrier, it would be quite cool in this room. So instead of paying somebody to do this for me, I decided to buy all of the supplies and try my hand at repairing this myself. I am aware that it is pretty hard to get even drywall, and typically when you go to a professional, they can make this look very seamless, so you don't actually see that a patch has been completed on the wall. But again, I'm somebody who loves DIY and doing home renos, so one, I wanted to learn this so I know for the future, and two, I wanted to make a video to show you guys how this is achieved. So repairing this area is going to consist of two parts. And actually I couldn't find a YouTube video online to explain how to do this whole project in one scenario. For my own research, I looked up a video of how to repair the vapor barrier, and then I looked up a separate video of how to repair a drywall hole. So I'm combining these two processes into my one project that I'm going to be completing today. So the first set of supplies I purchased to fix the vapor barrier was actually a plastic drop sheet. Now, the reason I purchased this was I just need a small section of replacement vapor barrier plastic, and at my local hardware store I can only buy a giant roll of it for like $40. Talking to the sales associate there, they mentioned that using a plastic drop sheet and perhaps doubling up on a couple layers would in theory give me the exact same type of product as purchasing the vapor barrier, but this only cost me $5, where buying the whole roll would have cost me about $40. Next, I also got some shims. On the YouTube video that I watched, the guy actually referred to them as furring strips, so I don't know if that's a different product that he used, but the reason I got these was to insert a strip into the hole here, and then that gives me a base to actually screw the new piece of drywall into so that it is stable and secure and actually fastened to something inside the wall. From there, I also got some tuck tape. So this is special vapor barrier type tape. It's usually red. This I bought so I can fasten my new plastic sheet to the old vapor barrier area. As well, I got an X-Acto knife. This I'm going to be using to cut the hole a little bit bigger so that I actually have exposed vapor barrier that has no rips, and that is what I'm going to be adhering the new plastic to so that I can have the new vapor barrier sealed completely to the old vapor barrier. Okay, so the first step I'm going to be taking today is actually using a ruler and a pencil. I'm just going to be drawing out a larger square than the square I have now so that I can have some of that exposed vapor barrier showing that I can adhere the new plastic to. Alright, and now using my X-Acto knife, I'm just going to score the lines that I've made. I want to be sure I'm not cutting all the way through the drywall. Again, if you do this, you're then cutting into the vapor barrier again, so I do not want to do this. I'm just scoring the lines, so going through about halfway through the drywall with my X-Acto knife. Also going to put some relief scoring in all of the corners so that it makes it a little bit easier to actually punch out these sections here. Okay, so I've done all of my scoring. I'm now going to attempt to remove these sections of drywall here. So again, I haven't cut through the vapor barrier again, but I've made it easy for my line to be totally contained. now I'm just going to work with my crowbar and I'm going to just try and clean up these edges a little bit so that it's totally clean when I put my new piece of drywall in there. Alright, so I've got the hole cleaned up pretty good. I'm now gonna go ahead and tape on my plastic square so that I can attach my plastic to all of the exposed vapor barrier around the edges here. Okay, so basically I've taken the old vapor barrier, I put it back into the hole, and then I've taken the tuck tape and taped it all back in place. I've also taken the tuck tape and put it around where any of those rips or tears were. I'm just trying to be extra diligent that wherever any of the original vapor barrier had been torn, I want to make sure there's a piece of tuck tape there covering it before I put the new plastic on. This might not be something that you have to do, but I just want to make do with the vapor barrier that's already there and just using that vapor barrier to add another level of protection to this fix. Okay, so I do have my new piece of plastic that I've cut. Through my research on YouTube, I did see that the best course of action is actually to line up two of the sides of your plastic, and then you can cut the other two sides to fit your square. Alright, so I have totally finished putting my plastic and tuck taping it to the actual vapor barrier. So now this is all contained, it's all sealed. Again, I have like three layers of plastic, so I taped up the original vapor barrier, I then put one piece of plastic and then a second piece of plastic, and then reinforced all of the seams with the tuck tape. I even put extra tuck tape in all of the corners just to make sure that all of those joints were actually sealed. So I'm really happy with how that came together. The tuck tape is super sticky, so if you are doing this on your own, it really will just stick to anything, even your fingers, so you might have to wash your hands multiple times while dealing with this tape. So I am ready for the second portion of this fix, which is adhering the new drywall piece into the hole. Now I did actually get some of these shims so that I could put a shim in here so I could actually apply the drywall to that piece and it would be fixed just a little bit better. However, I do know that there's a stud not that far from where my hole is, so I actually think I'm going to just cut this hole a little bit bigger so that my new drywall piece can actually be screwed right into the two studs that are already there, and then I won't actually need these. So I'm going to give that a go and we'll see if it works. Okay, so I have cut the hole bigger so that I have two exposed studs. I have one stud right here, and then I have a second stud right here. These are going to be like my anchor points to adhere the new piece of drywall to. So from my basement, I just brought up an old piece that we had in the basement from the previous homeowner. So this is what I'm going to cut because it's not quite wide enough to cover the whole hole. I am going to cut this into a couple of different pieces. From there, I do have this drywall tape. So this is what you use to put along the seams. Talking to a friend of mine who's kind of giving me some advice for this project, he actually said if I do cut my drywall just a little bit larger and leave a 1-inch overlap, I actually can chip off the middle part of the drywall and just leave this paper flap to go over the edge of the hole. That will act as kind of like a seam in itself, so I won't have to actually use the seam tape. I'm going to try and give that a try because I do think that'll be a little smoother transition when I go in with my drywall putty. So once I have my pieces fastened and I have either that lip of drywall around the edges or I have my drywall tape around the edges, I'm then gonna go ahead and put the drywall putty around all of my patches using my spackling tools here to do that, as well as my sanding block to kind of smooth everything down. Talking to the lady at the store when I purchased all this stuff, she said I may have to repeat that process a couple of times to make sure that it looks nice and smooth and even. So again, I'm gonna go in there once with the sander, sand everything down. If I don't quite feel like it's totally evened, I'll repeat that process a second time. The other items that I'll be using are obviously drywall screws to fasten the new piece of drywall to the studs, as well as my drill here. Okay, you guys, so I have my new piece of drywall, I have my measuring tape. I'm now just going to measure this hole, and then I am going to create my two pieces of drywall to do the patch. Measured my piece of drywall. I've put an X in this interior line here. This is the actual piece of drywall that I need to put in inside the hole. And then this perimeter edge here, that's the excess that I am just going to chip away all of that little gyp rock out of, and then keep that top layer of paper on so I can use that as my seaming strip. So again, I'm just going to try and see if this works. If not, I do have that seaming tape that I can use as well. But again, I think this is going to work out a little bit nicer and leave a little bit cleaner of a line. As you can see, I do have my piece of drywall here, and then I've got about that inch along all the sides. So when I stick this in here, I do have that excess paper that's going to just fit nicely over the edges instead of doing the drywall tape. All right, so now I'm going to take my drywall screws and screw this in to my stud here and my stud over here. All right, so now I'm going to repeat that step with the second piece as well. Okay, you guys, so I have both pieces of drywall up and I do have them screwed into both of the studs. This process took a little while for the bottom piece just because I had to get it the perfect size to fit in the remainder of the hole. But I'm so happy that I finally have my patch here. The little flaps turned out great. I think these are going to work perfectly to help create this seam just a little bit finer and a little bit cleaner, so that hopefully when I finish the rest of the process, you're not even going to be able to tell that I do have a patch in this wall. All right, the next part of the process is taking my drywall putty here, using my spackle, and just putting it all over the edges, over top of the screw marks, so that I can spread it out, and then sand that down. guys. So I've totally done one whole coat of the putty. I'm now gonna go in and sand it. It's been drying for about 24 hours and I actually picked up a new bucket of putty because I think I'm gonna have to do this probably two more times to make it look pretty even. But talking to a few other people, I don't think I'm going to be able to get this patch completely even and to make it super seamless so it's not there, but I'm gonna try my best to sand it down and keep doing this process until I can get it as seamless as I can. I have completely patched the hole. I have done all of my drywall mudding as well. I've probably done about four or five coats of mud over my patch. Talking to some of the people who've been helping me out with this project, everybody said if it doesn't look smooth when it's just the mud, it's going to look even worse when you paint over it. After doing about three coats of mudding, I decided, okay, I think I should paint over it now, even though I could still see a few bumps and grooves and things. So again, I was told that was a mistake. Keep mudding it until there's no bumps, no grooves left over, and then go in with your paint. So here I am, four or five layers of mud later, and I'm finally ready to paint. So also talking to the people that were helping me with this project, they said to make sure that I paint the whole wall, not just the patch, because that definitely makes a difference on how well it blends. So I'm not cutting in and doing all the edges of the wall, but I'm making sure that I am covering majority of the wall with new paint so that the patch blends in better. I may have to do this twice. I'll see kind of how it looks in the daylight, and then maybe I'll have to do another coat later this evening or possibly tomorrow as well. Okay, you guys, so I have completely finished patching the hole in my wall. As you can see, it really does look quite professional. I am beyond proud of myself and proud of the work that I was able to do on this repair. So to recap the whole process, because this is an exterior wall, I had to fix all of the vapor barrier, I had to put a new piece of drywall in the wall, and then I had to mud over the hole about five times, as well as the sanding and then repainting. So I really did about five layers of mud. This is crucial. If you guys are doing this project, you can't just go in with the paint after a couple rounds of mudding. You really do have to go over all of your seams with mud, I would say probably four to five times, or at least until there are no imperfections. You cannot hide any of the imperfections with the paint. You do have to smooth them out with the mudding process. For anybody that's come to this video because you want to attempt a project like this on your own, honestly, if I can do it, anybody can. Just make sure you watch a few videos on how to actually do this. I couldn't find any videos that had the repair for the vapor barrier and patching the hole in the drywall. So hopefully you do get a lot of use out of this video, but again, go and do some research in other videos, see what techniques you think are going to work best for you. These techniques work great for me, and I learned these through talking to different people in my life who are quite handy. As well, any of the professionals at the hardware store that you go to. I'm very lucky that I do have a local store here in my community. It's a husband and wife that run the store, so they are very handy. They gave me lots of ideas and lots of tips on how to finish this project. As well, the other thing that I would say is just patience, right? So I took a lot of time. This took me about 2 weeks to film and to repair, simply because you do have to let the mud sit for about 24 hours before you can go in and sand it. So again, with 5 coats, it does take a long time and it is a long process. And I didn't want to rush it. I wanted to make sure that I was doing it perfectly. And I was constantly talking to the handy people in my life, sending photos and getting them to check up on the process just to make sure I was on the right path and doing it the correct way. And again, I'm very happy with how it turned out. So if I can do it, I am sure you guys, anybody else out there can do it, as long as you take your time, do the research, and have a little bit of patience while you're doing your project. If you guys haven't already, be sure to subscribe to my YouTube channel. As well, check out my website and be sure to follow me on Instagram. Thank you guys so much for watching, and we'll see you next time.